I seriously cannot see myself playing this thing. Every time I want to play a game, I run into some sort of trouble. And I want to be able to expand my Steam library from something relatively minimal at the moment to something comprehensive. But I just don't trust games to run well on Steam Deck. For those console gamers or anyone else looking to jump over to Steam Deck, I would seriously avoid it. And here's why. This boggy handheld PC is all the rage right now, largely due to people not actually being able to get their hands on one despite pre-ordering them so long ago. Demand for this piece of tech is high, and while Valve don't have quite the production runs compared to other gaming manufacturers, they are managing to squeeze out some into the market. For those still waiting, then I have done a video on what to expect when you get the pre-order. Click on the card on the screen now to view that video if you want to see the pre-order process. Well, what is a Steam Deck? The Steam Deck is a handheld hybrid PC, not too dissimilar from the concept of the Nintendo Switch, except for that is not a PC. It can be used with a USB-C docking station to connect it to a monitor, or it can be played in its handheld form factor. There aren't any detachable Joy-Con controllers though, like with the Switch, but controllers can be connected via the USB-C port and/or docking station. My Thunderbolt 4 docking station would connect accessories just fine, such as a mouse and keyboard, and also my Ethernet cable, but for some reason it just wouldn't find the HDMI cable. Now I've tried an alternate HDMI cable, but my PC works just fine with the docking station. I tried booting Steam into desktop mode to fiddle with the settings, but, well, no luck. It just wouldn't find it. Perhaps the problem is more Thunderbolt versus USB-C related, but it should be backwards compatible. Perhaps some sort of driver fix will sort this out in the coming months. I did, however, test a separate docking station, and this did work. The deck comes with a default Steam OS, and this will most likely be the experience that the majority of players will have with it. The Steam OS is easy to understand, but sometimes, well, funky to navigate, particularly the store, which brings up a web version of the store rather than a baked-in OS version. It can run slow, and it will take time for the next items to load. Navigating into a game in the store and then backing out of it can take you to the back of the top of the page, and you may have to scroll back through to get to the part of the store you were looking at in the first place. There is a section in the store which recommends which games are great on deck, and this will undoubtedly grow over time. Likewise, it could only be a matter of time before the storefront itself is fixed. The Steam store will tell you what games are verified, but also games that are playable on deck. These games largely work, but then there are some menus that are difficult to navigate, or there are controller issues. The unit itself has got a good quality heft to it. It feels solid. The materials feel premium, but at the same time, I'm not sure if I'd be willing to test its durability. I'm sure that Valve will claim that there is a certain degree of ruggedness and drop-proof testing, but I would say that the Steam Deck is only one drop away from certain disaster. That's not so much a slight on Valve, not at all, no. It's more about the type of beast that it is. After all, it is over double the weight of a Nintendo Switch at 669 grams. Or 1 pound and 7.5 ounces for you Imperials out there. Handheld gaming machines from Nintendo, bar the Switch, have always had an element of durability, but knowing what the Steam Deck is packing is more what would make me paranoid about dropping it. Treat this as you would treat a laptop, and take extra care not to drop it around. Fortunately, Valve provide a carry case for the Deck, free of charge. The carry case has indents for the buttons and joysticks and has a hard shell design. There is also a drawstring bag which can fit behind the elastic strap on the back to carry a charge cable or other bits and pieces. Also, personally, I wouldn't trust this coming loose and falling out of the case. There is a full list of specs on the Steam Deck page, although I'd be lying if I said I'd fully know about the comparative CPUs and GPU specs. Storage comes in three different sizes: 64GB eMMC, 256GB NVMe SSD, and 512GB NVMe SSD, although both SSDs are Gen 3, so they're not quite as fast as they could have been. All units come with an easy-to-use microSD card slot, and theoretically you could open up the Steam Deck to use the 2230 M.2 slot to add additional storage. Not that Valve recommend this. The thing is, I've not really seen that much speed from the Steam Deck. It can take quite some time to boot up a game compared to the average gaming console or PC. Even smaller, less demanding indie games can take a long time loading. For example, Something like Sonic Mania takes over 20 seconds to get to the menu screen. Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order took 1 minute and 51 seconds to get into the game. A really slow speed when considering it is loading it from an SSD. Part of the reason for this is the DRM checks through Steam, or in this case, Origin. Also, I started running into trouble with certain games. For example, Jedi Fallen Order, despite being in the advert for the Steam Deck, isn't actually Steam Deck verified. Now, the main issue is actually booting the game. If you're booting the game cold, i.e. you don't already have it open, then you will need to connect to EA Origin to verify your account, / DRM. I found this to be incredibly annoying as I intended to play it on a flight, only to have to play something else. It only needs to verify this on boot, and a constant internet connection isn't required. But it was still just, well, annoying. Jedi Fallen Order on the most part performs well, but there are slight stutters and the odd juddery frame and frequent texture pop in, which begs the question, will the Steam Deck be redundant after a short period on the market? The PC marketplace is relentless when it comes to frequently requiring more powerful components, and in some cases, the Deck is already struggling to keep up with older releases, especially as I paid more for this handheld than I have done for the Switch or a PS5. Will we see concessions being made for Deck-verified versions of games, similar to how devs make concessions on Switch ports? Well, time will tell. Thankfully, there are a handful of performance settings that may help improve these things, such as manually changing and forcing the frame rate limit to 15, 30, or 60 frames per second. The refresh rate can be set as low as 40 and as high as 60, and you can also boot games using different versions of Proton if you desire to do so. Among other options are those that can be geared to save the Steam Deck's battery, including half-rate shading, thermal power limit, and manual GPU clock control. Playing around with these, as well as turning Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and Rumble off, didn't really seem to make a huge difference on battery life, and playing games at a fraction of how they are designed to play doesn't sound like my idea of fun anyway. Battery life can vary enormously, depending on the type of game that's being played, and can vary anywhere between 2 to 5 hours. During this time, the Deck might start steaming via its vent. Oh boy, what a noise can this make? Nonetheless though, as long as it's doing its job, well, I'm happy. A recent update has somewhat reduced the fan activity, but at the same time, I wouldn't want to compromise the temperature of the unit at this expense. We all remember what happened to overheating Xbox 360s and PS3s. Now, my Steam library isn't huge, and admittedly, I have only ever used it to claim a humble bundled Sonic Mega Pack years ago. However, my excitement of playing Sonic Adventure and Sonic Adventure 2 was muted when I found out that neither game was compatible. Or, at least by Steam standards. The thing is, both, with a bit of tinkering, work fine. Sonic Adventure flat out says it's not supported, but, well, it works. Sonic Adventure 2 just needed some controller adjustments, and thanks to the community controller layouts for sorting that out. Conversely, there are Deck-verified games, such as the Sonic Racing games, Sonic & Sega All-Stars Racing and Sonic Racing Transformed, with the latter being verified for Deck, yet despite so many attempts to get it to boot, it just wouldn't. I fussed around with this to get it to work, and while it didn't take much to get it to work, it did make me feel a bit uneasy that the Deck couldn't handle this game from over a decade ago on high settings. Similar issues cropped up in Sonic Generations, a game from 2011, with extreme slowdown and framerate issues. I tried playing eFootball, the free-to-play successor to PES, but unfortunately, other than the tutorial, I couldn't get the game to boot past the loading screen. I have lost quite a lot of confidence to buy games on Steam, even if they are verified, because I have a feeling they won't work on Deck, especially when their digital prices are much more than their console counterparts. I worry for what the Steam Deck will become. In one way, it feels quite redundant already. I am not sold on playing current or even last-gen games on this machine, at least the AAA games. I didn't buy it thinking I'd be able to play games from the 2020s, but heck, I had hoped that games from last-gen would run, well, at least okay. There are other ways to play games though, such as the Epic Game Store, which can be added to your deck with some workaround solutions. This isn't necessarily a hard process, but it's not exactly user-friendly either. For those looking to do this, then there are some handy YouTube tutorials to get it running on deck. And for the most part, it runs fine. Likewise, I don't have a large library, but have redeemed some free games from Epic when they have them on offer. Microsoft also have a step-by-step guide to get xCloud gaming on the deck via Microsoft Edge. Unfortunately, despite following the steps to the letter, all I get greeted is with a white screen when I open the app. I hope that Microsoft are working on a native app, as I think this would be a great option to play some games via the cloud for those who don't have an Xbox. There are also those who wish to use the deck as an emulation device, and Valve make this rather easy to do by literally having a whole list of emulators ready to download. I'm not going to go into this, not just for the legal purposes, but just because this isn't the primary function of the machine, even if it is a nifty one. This is going to sound a little spoilt of me, but as a console gamer all my life, I put a game in and it loads. It works. Well, for the most part. It is what has always put me off PC gaming, not knowing if my graphics card was good enough, or if I had enough RAM, or well, whatever else. This uncertainty, I had hoped, was to be somewhat rectified with the Steam Deck, with at least a verified library. But unfortunately, my fears are not allayed. I sit here now, with a device that I can really barely be bothered to boot up because of these annoyances. If you're on the fence about this machine, or a console gamer looking to be converted, then this is not the one. At least, not yet. Thanks for taking the time to watch my Steam Deck review. If you like this video, then please leave it a like. If you disagree, then please leave me a comment. Be kind. But guys, for now, that's everything. I'll see you on the next video.